Is being first always the most important? Hi everyone, and welcome to Saluso and to another Versus episode. Today we're looking at the two titans of the big watch trend. The Audemars Piguet Roya Oak Offshore, provided to us by Zager Watches in Sydney, Australia, and the Hublot Big Bang Chronograph, provided to us by Timepiece 360 in Dubai. Make sure to check out both of their links in the description below. And let's get right into this Versus. Now there's always comparisons between the Hublot to the Roya Oak. Jean-Claude Beaver has even openly admitted that if people are comparing us to the Royal Oak, that's a good thing. I want people to make that association, and it is a good one. And obviously, when you look at the two, you can see a lot of parallels. I'm going to explore that in this Versus, in addition to all the other categories that I do for these episodes. And just to sum up, those are the design, the history, their versatility, their technical capability, and their value. And in the description, you can find shortcuts to any of those if you want to skip around as well. But let's get right into it with design, and let's start with the originator, the OG, and that is the Roya Oak Offshore. The Offshore has often been described as a standard Roya Oak on steroids, and you can see that in pretty much every dimension has just been pumped up and really increased in terms of thickness and size, even down to the waffle dial, which features these big thick squares compared to the nice fine little squares that you might find on a standard Roya Oak. But it is still unmistakably an Audemars Piguet Royal Oak at the end of the day. You've got the octagonal bezel, the octagonal screws, all properly aligned. And in this case, you have a proportionally sized version of the Audemars Piguet bracelet, which is of course integrated with a nice little hairline bevel going down the side of it, as well as differential finish on the bezel as well, and a mostly satin finish for the rest of it, with polish being used more than anything to create character lines and to break up the design a little bit. Ironically, it is a somewhat discreet approach to a big watch. Obviously, all the ostentatious part is taken over by the actual size of the thing. Meanwhile, the Big Bang, well, it is typical of what we've come to expect from Hublot. First off, of course, it does have the misaligned bezel screws, which some people take issue with. I personally don't mind, but those are on a ceramic bezel on a steel case with a resin outside, titanium core, a rubber strap, and a titanium clasp, and with a carbon fiber looking dial. Essentially, it's that multi-material look that we've come to expect from Hublot, and you can see it right away, and it makes sense. This was the originator of that renaissance for the art of fusion, as they call it over at Hublot, and this completely exemplifies that. Also, you notice a lot more use of differential finish. It's not just for accentuating small lines. You actually do get a lot of reflectivity on that near scratch-proof bezel, and they also have large chunks of the case finished in high polish, contrasting with the matte finish of the resin and the satin finish on some parts of the case as well. So really from every angle it plays with the light, and there's a lot going on, but it also seems more streamlined. This is a big watch, but somehow it has a more aerodynamic feel to it. So even just looking at them side to side, you can tell that while yes, there are parallels, they are clearly very different aesthetic visions. In my view, the AP takes the win on this for styling though, narrowly, but it still does. I like the fact that it has a more discreet look with the full satin finish. I like the fact that it's also a little bit easier to read and a bit less busy than the Hublot. But don't get me wrong, the Hublot is a great looking watch as well. I just feel that the AP executes that look a little bit better. Next we have history, and again let's start with the one who has the advantage, and that is of course the Audemars Piguet Royal Oak Offshore. Audemars Piguet was founded in 1875 to 1871, depending on when you count the actual founding. They received the name in 81, however they partnered up as early as 1975. Since then, they have been known as part of the Holy Trinity of watchmaking of Patek Philippe, Audemars Piguet, and Vacheron Constantin, and they have spearheaded high horology along with those other two. And of course, in more recent history, their big development was introducing this entire segment in 1972 when they released the original Audemars Piguet Royal Oak. Essentially, what they were doing is they were saying that they made watches so well, their finish was so perfect, that it didn't need to be precious metal to cost as much as something made in gold. That this was for people who, they didn't need gold to show off. Instead, it was they could get something that was so well made in steel and still spend what they would on a gold watch. So in many ways, it was not only the first sports watch, but to a degree, it was also the first fuck you watch. I can spend as much as you spend on gold on steel. And that pretty much set off the entire segment. Then in 1993, they introduced the Offshore itself, essentially to breathe new life into the segment and to breathe new life into the collection. And if the original Royal Oak was the original fuck you watch, then definitely the Offshore put that in all caps. It was big, it was brash. This was still a time where Rolex presidents were easily found in 36mm variants, where their tool watch, the Submariner, was still 40mm, and not with a super case either. So coming out with a watch like this, as big, as chunky, with this sort of presence, was definitely a game changer. And while that did give license to a degree for Panerai not to look as gigantic, it didn't really catch on in the same way as in 2005 when Hublot, originally founded in 1980, came out with the Big Bang. The Big Bang was a renaissance for Hublot. They had been around at the time for 25 years as they sold the progenitor to the Classic Fusion, which came up with the idea of pairing gold, a precious metal, with a rubber strap. That was their original Fusion, and the Big Bang took it to another level. It was still large, measuring in at 44mm, and really what it's done is it's cemented and brought into the mainstream so many concepts that other brands may have started, but they really brought it into the mainstream. Think, for example, the big watch trend. Yes, Audemars Piguet may have started that as early as 93, but it really didn't start catching on until Hublot came out with the Big Bang. They were really pushing it. It really went mainstream when Hublot did it because of the way that Hublot markets itself. And the same thing with this multi-material approach. Richard Mille, for example, was already doing that in 2001 when they came out with their first watch. But it was Hublot who really brought that notion to the forefront with the Big Bang. The Big Bang was also at the forefront of a lot of their sponsorship deals, entering Formula One, entering soccer. These were bridging new worlds for the watch industry in a way that Audemars Piguet hadn't really been able to penetrate. The people who knew about them still knew about them, but the mainstream saw Hublot as the spearhead. I often liken it to something like Apple when they came out with the iPhone. By no means did they invent the touchscreen, but what they did is the way they marketed it, the way they packaged it, the way they brought it to market, made it what it is now, ubiquitous. So in this sense, I feel at least, and I know this might be a bit controversial, I feel actually the Hublot has more historical significance than the AP. Without a doubt, AP as a company is more historically significant, but in modern times and in what they've done in a short time and in terms of what they brought to the mainstream, not just the niche of ultra luxury, the Big Bang has had a bigger impact on the industry as a whole relative to the Offshore. Next, we have Versatility, and well, neither of these is going to be your dress watch. In my original review of the Hublot, I said maybe you can pull it off as a bit of a fuck you statement. In that sense, I feel the AP doesn't have that same capability. But I do also have to say that the AP is a little bit friendlier to smaller wrists. It pulls off a similar sort of trick that Rolex does by looking bigger than it is without actually having to have the measurements. It's not as big and it's not as thick as the Hublot, but yet it still has the same amount of presence. And when you talk about versatility, you also need to talk about the options for straps. At the end of the day, it's a lot easier to find non-OEM manufacturers of AP style straps versus the Hublot ones, because Hublot has so many different strap types. They have the click-in straps, they have the ones for the Big Bang, they have the ones for the Classic Fusion with the screws. It's a lot easier, in my view at least, to change around your AP versus to change around your Hublot if you don't want to go for the OEM route. But also, both of these have 100 meters of water resistance. I would say that the Hublot is also a fair bit lighter on the wrist, but you might want a bit more presence on your wrist. It's a toss-up, but I would say that the AP narrowly wins out because it is that little bit more discreet, and I think that lends a bit more versatility. So for that, I give the versatility victory to the Offshore. When it comes to the technical capacity of these two, it is difficult to judge because in terms of functions, they both do exactly the same thing. Automatic, three-register chronograph with a date. However, they go about it in completely different ways. The Hublot makes use of a Salida SW510, which is a descendant of the Baojiu 7750 that's used in pretty much every chronograph for the last 20-30 years that isn't a manufacturer movement. On the other hand, the AP makes use of its own in-house base caliber and then uses a Dubois de Prez chronograph module on top. So whereas the Baojiu is an integrated chronograph, the AP is a modular one. That's why when you look at the AP from the side, you'll notice that the pushers are actually a little bit higher than the crown. And also that's why they have to have a cyclops for the date, because it's all a little bit higher. But somehow, the AP manages to be thinner, despite both of them having the same amount of water resistance. However, the AP is still more technically sophisticated, and let's not even start on decoration. From a technical standpoint, it has a gold rotor, which is a more dense metal, making it more efficient when it comes to winding. Also, it has a full balance bridge and has a 50-hour power reserve versus the 42 of the Hublot movement. Definitely a win for the AP when it comes to the technical capacity. And now we come to the value of these watches. And because this particular iteration of the Offshore has been discontinued since 2016, I'm going to be looking at the pre-owned value of these, especially because at the end of the day, as I mentioned in my original review of the Big Bang chronograph, this particular version of the Big Bang, its retail price has sort of outlasted it in terms of $13,000 nearly for a 7750 base on a watch that's been around since 2005. It doesn't make sense anymore, in my view, whereas the pre-owned is really where the value is at for that watch in general. For a bit of perspective, on the pre-owned market, you can get one for as low as $6,000 or $7,000 US, up to about its retail price of $13,000, $12,000 thereabouts. And that upper cap is mostly people who are too optimistic, people who've maybe just bought it, and people who think that they can resell it for what they paid for, essentially, which with this watch, I don't think is gonna happen. Where the fun is at is around that $6,000 or $7,000 mark, because then you're comparing it to other 7750 based watches, but that don't have that same specialness to them. This is, at the end of the day, still a watch that feels like a $13,000 watch, but you can get it for half that. Meanwhile, on the value front, the AP has actually gone up in value since last year when I reviewed it. When I reviewed it last year on the pre-owned market, it was ranging from about $14,000 to $17,000 US on Chrono 24. Now when I checked to make this video, the cheapest one I could find was around $15,000 and the upper cap was around $32,000. Now I think those selling for around $32,000 are a little bit too optimistic. However, the fact that that range has really broadened despite the current Corona crisis shows that this watch has some staying power and it could actually retain its value quite well if you purchase it right. Since both of these are realistic only on the pre-owned market where it's much more volatile, you have to consider that probably now would be a good time to get the AP if you have the money for it. So because of the fact that its value is actually increasing and it's still, in my view, quite competitive compared to a regular steel Royal Oak, for example, I definitely have to give that value win to the Royal Oak Offshore as well. So if we tally those up, the AP won in four categories. The only one that Hublot won out was in history, and I still stand by that. However, this was by no means a walkover. In the design and in the versatility categories especially, I feel like it could have gone either way. Design is extremely subjective, and in versatility, these watches are both very, very closely matched. It's really down to if you prioritize the sizing versus the lightness and comfort. But it really does amaze me how close these two are. I think if this was a different comparison, if this was the Unico versus the Offshore or the Big Bang versus the standard Royal Oak, I think the outcome would have been very different. But these two are actually surprisingly well matched in my opinion, and it was really interesting seeing how well matched they really are, considering both of these haven't changed that much in decades, literally. But in any case, those are all just my opinions. I'd love to know in the comments below, what do you think of these two? Do you think they're as closely matched as they seem? Did watching this video help show that these do actually have quite distinct designs and perhaps aren't as close as you might have originally thought? And if you were in the position to buy a new Big Bang chronograph at around that $13,000 mark, would you get a pre-owned one and save yourself half the money? Or would you save half the money more and get a Royal Oak Offshore? I'd love to know your opinions in the comments below. And of course, if you like the video, make sure you like it and share it. And if you want to see more pictures and infographics of these watches, make sure you follow me on Instagram at Saluso. And another big thanks to Timepiece 360 for providing the Big Bang, Zeiger Watches for providing the Offshore. You can find their links in the description below, as well as links to the original reviews of both of these watches. And if you want to see some more videos about watches, make sure that you subscribe to the channel and hit the notification bell so you know every time I put up a new video. And last but not least, thanks for watching this video, and we'll catch you on the next one.